Hi, I'm Mort Cooper, your host on Change Your Voice, Change Your Life. I just had a little chit-chat with Dr. Curtis, who is guesting with us. He's been with us over the years. And we wrote a book called Curing Hopeless Voice Problems about SD, spasmodic dysphonia. Today's title is The Lady Killers. Why The Lady Killers? Because those people who have very severe voice problems, such as those enduring and suffering with a strangled voice, and that's what it sounds like. When you hear the strangled voice, you're not the same, and it's traumatic, not only for the listener, but for the person speaking. So in studio, we have with us somebody who has had this condition. I believe you've had it, Tony Wilkers.
For about 30 years.
What does it sound like?
It sounds like it sounds like a monster voice. It sounds like someone is strangling you and you're trying to talk. It's very forced.
Is that what it's sounding like now?
Yeah. I know. I need to get my pitch up, right, Doc?
Yes. Your laugh is your voice.
She's strangled when her pitch is up. Why is that?
No.
Wait a second.
Yeah.
This is a neurological condition that you have. This is a permanent dystonia.
Yes,
what are you talking about?
What the medics.
Why is there? How did you change? What did you do to change your voice? This is not possible.
It's magic.
Tony, what's the magic?
The magic is for me to keep my pitch up
and
to breathe.
Can you do it?
It's hard. It is very, very hard. I can do it, but it takes a lot of practice.
Yeah, you don't like the higher pitch.
It's not natural.
You don't like the
I don't.
Pitch.
I don't.
It's girlish.
I sound like a 12-year-old.
Yes,
she does. Why do you want to create a gorgeous,
to the voice.
Sexy, a very charismatic
John
woman?
Curtis,
why do you
listen
take
to the laugh.
And transfer
listen,
these people back to pre-puberty?
Listen to that laugh. Your
a
laugh is gorgeous.
Pre-pubescent voice you're giving her. Yes. This is not appropriate.
You're not doing a very good job here for my ego there.
Why did you lower the pitch of your voice? This is honest time.
Honest time?
Yes. We don't have much honest time in our society.
There would be actually two aspects to it. The first would be to sound, I'm dropping it again,
it
to sound
like
more
people
professional.
People out there listening to you think that there's something wrong with their reception.
Yeah, it's because it goes all over the place.
But that's called, folks, spasmodic dysphonia, the strangled voice.
Mm-hmm. But her voice is dropping down into her lower
throat. Yes, well, we're going to ask why.
Because my high-pitched voice doesn't sound professional. That's
who
one
told
thing.
You that?
Nobody. I thought that myself.
Look,
on top of that, my husband also thinks I'm very high-pitched, and he says I can break glass in restaurants with my voice. So I'm very. He's always
so
telling
he
me to
brought
hush
you
it
down
a little
bit. And change your identity.
He's got a very low-pitched voice, and my voice just sets him crazy.
You got into this condition slowly. You got
mm-hmm.
into it when?
Mm-hmm.
At 18 years of age?
Mm-hmm. It started at 18, but it's in the last 2 years, it's gotten a lot worse.
Mm-hmm. Where do you feel your voice?
Significantly worse.
Where do you feel it?
Right here, in my throat.
Okay. Stay away from that microphone, otherwise they'll believe you really have. They have auditory problems at the other end. Okay?
Okay, sir.
Can you say mm-hmm?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
You have trouble.
Mm-hmm. It's hard. And I can't hum. Normal things, I just can't do
them. Can you hum when you stand in place and run?
If I put my arms in the air.
Yes, you can. John, that's a laugh. That's her voice. Her voice is her laugh.
It is
high. It's a high pitch.
That's why I should
look,
be
her
speaking.
Husband, you're going to break her marriage up.
I know.
You get her
I know that.
Too
We've already discussed it.
He's going to run away.
Yeah. He loves you, doesn't he?
Yeah, except for the voice thing.
Your laugh is very much in your face. Now, you talked about the neurological.
No, look, they've said, look, I've spoken with many medical experts on this subject. Mm-hmm. And I know you have a differing point of view than they do. They believe this is a neurological condition.
A basal ganglia problem, a neurological problem.
I just want you to answer.
A genetic problem.
Yes, can you tell me how much neurological training you have? Because I want to know how it's possible for you to fix a neurological problem. Are you a neurologist?
Dr. Curtis, the answer is, he always asks me the question. I'm not a neurologist. I'm not into the neurological attribute.
How is that possible to fix a neurological problem?
Because it's not a neurological problem.
The medics say it's neurological.
The medics are off base. They're on the wrong road. I report cures. We just sent the book out. And that book will be in the library pretty soon, called Curing Hopeless Voices. But the issue, and the hopeless voices is spasmodic dysphonia. The issue is their modus operandi, their paradigm. The medical community has never had one single cure since Traub, Ludwig Traub, in 1871, first described your condition as nervous hoarseness. When you use that voice, do you get nervous?
Yeah, when I use my strangled voice? Yeah, yeah, everything gets tight, yeah.
Yes. Well, he noticed that characteristic, so he called it the nervous voice. Now, the problem is the medical people have medicalized you.
And it makes you sound nervous, too.
Yeah, they have medicalized you. Do you know what that means?
They give us absolutely no hope. I mean, there's nothing.
Right. Well, no, hope. It just means that they need to treat it as a medical problem.
Yeah, they're making her a disease.
So what are her options? What are her medical treatment options?
She can have Botox, for botulinum and Tox for toxin.
What is that? Is that?
It's a deadly poison.
How can somebody give you a deadly poison?
Botox.
No doctor is going to inject somebody with a weapon of mass destruction. This is how is that possible?
We went to war against Saddam Hussein, believing he had that botulinum toxin.
Actually, botulism. You know where I heard that the botulinum toxin disappeared, and somehow they found it at a warehouse down in Irvine, California.
Yes,
it's called Irvine, the maker of Botox, Allergan Inc.
I wouldn't have my doubts about a lot of things, but I question the basic attribute, the basic paradigm of the medical community. They have never had one single cure in 135 plus years because they're treating the condition as a medical problem. And my take, it is not a medical problem. Now, here's the other thing that blows everybody's mind. I have 15 cures reported of spasmodic dysphonic cases diagnosed at UCLA Medical Center. That's over a period of years. I report 15 cures of those conditions. The answer as to why I can do that is because I'm using all-natural approach called direct voice rehabilitation. Now, as far as people have asked me, and you've asked me, why don't I teach? And my answer is, I can't get invited or into any meeting today in the medical field or academia with a newsie.
You know what a newsie is, folks?
It's a submachine, an Israeli submachine.
It's crazy. I mean, you know, there's a lot of people out there with this problem, and we need more doctors who will do something other than give us botulism shots.
Yes. I estimate millions, the same percentage as stutterers in this country, which is 1 to 2 or 3 million stutterers in this country. But think worldwide, if that's so, then there are countless millions of people suffering from spasmodic dysphonia. And the reason they suffer from it is the lady killers. What do I mean by that?
I'm not sure. Why don't you
explain
it to me?
John, you know what I mean?
With the lady killers?
Yeah.
What? You know, that.
Why? Why?
The voice itself.
Yeah.
Don't you think the voice can either be something very appealing, something very inviting, or something that can really turn people off?
That's right.
Don't you think that this is a turnoff to a lot of guys? They hear a voice that sounds like this. They get scared.
Yeah.
I mean, they think, well, what's wrong with the people?
But the ladies want to sound more sexy.
Yeah.
They want to sound more with it. And most of
That's
the people throat. With SD, spasmodic dysphonia, right, are women, it is said. I don't find so. I think it's 50-50 percent. But it is also said that you cannot change the pitch of your voice. That's the NSDA. And if you do change it,
okay,
it's going to be an impairment to your health. I've seen that on the chat room from the NSDA, National Spasmodic Dysphonic Association. They do not believe that you can change it, and if you do change it, they're making negative evaluations of it. But you can't change it. Now, the medical community, John, is saying it's neurological, a basal ganglia problem, genetic, and so forth. Am I into those fields?
Well, that's what I was going to ask you.
I mean,
how much training have you had in neurology?
None.
So then how are you able to change a neurological condition?
I could change it because it's not neurological. That's the answer to it.
You think it's more of a mechanical problem.
Yes.
Is that what you would say, Doctor?
Yeah, when you say mechanical, say it again.
Mechanical.
Yes,
mechanical.
Say it higher. Why
say
don't
it in
you
a better
go
pitch.
Higher?
Mechanical.
That's right.
Mechanical.
Why don't
See,
you talk like
that?
And this
used to be my pitch, so it's not like I'm really changing it. I'm just trying to get it back.
Right.
to why where it used to why be.
She made a deliberate attempt in her life to really sound sexy and appealing.
Screwed me up real bad.
And now you're suggesting that changing her natural pitch is what it sabotaged her voice.
Yes, but she said she wanted a lower pitch because she felt it was too girlish.
No, she said her husband couldn't deal with her high-pitched voice.
And it was too girlish. The second attribute, the first one, you wanted to change it to begin with.
So she did that to herself. She wants more authority.
You wanted to change your pitch too. When you were younger, you sounded like, you know, you were out of the Brooklyn Bronxy area.
No, I didn't want to change.
You had a nasal.
Like this. No, I didn't want to change it. Two well-intentioned college professors at Brooklyn College said, "Don't talk like that. Talk all the way down here." And actually, it was a very effective voice.
Oh, it sounds good, but it probably wasn't good for you.
It blew out. And the more I used it, I used more force. Is that what happened to you?
Yes, you have to, because you can't get the words out. So then you're putting more pressure.
You can't get the sound out.
You can't get the sound. The words are trailing because you're talking down here. You're right. And then you're putting more and more pressure behind it, and it strangles even more.
Yeah. And the lower throat gets very tense.
But don't
right?
you think a strangled sounding voice sounds kind of aged?
Well,
I mean,
yeah,
it doesn't sound. It's not a youthful sound, is it? In your opinion?
No.
No.
John, why don't you?
He's trying to get us away from the strangled voice.
Look, I like your voice, John. Why don't you do it? Why don't you give us the sound of the strangled voice?
Well, I was on the phone with the former past president of the National Spasmodic Dysphonia Association, not the director I was telling you about. His name is former director. His name is Bob McAllister. He's the one that told me categorically when I asked him. I said, does your organization, NSDA, take a position about the use of Botox shots?
What is the
he
NSDA?
Said we're, that's the National Spasmodic Dysphonia Association.
It's funded by Allergan, the maker of Botox.
I asked him that question also. Uh-huh. Is it whether he receives funding from Allergan, Inc., the maker of Botox? He says, I'm not at liberty to answer that.
I think that's an answer.
I said, it's on your website. Why are you not at liberty to report on something that's actually listed on your website? This is the same kind of question, by the way, that I get when I ask Dr. Ludlow at the National Institutes of Health a very simple question. Dr. Ludlow, have you received any compensation or money or stock options of any kind, payments of any nature, from the drug maker Allergan Inc. over the last 10 years? No, I asked her that question. I said, can you just tell me?
You're wasting your breath.
It's a yes or no answer.
Yes.
A or B, yes or no. She says, I can't answer your question.
Dr. Curtis, you traumatize people.
And you know what she asked me?
Have you no sense of civility?
You know what she asked me? She said to me, you have to go through the Freedom of Information officer. And so I waited 4 months for the information that I asked.
You are a very patient soul. I must admit.
And you know what they gave me? They gave me an email that she had written to an attendee of a conference that she had sponsored, thanking them for participating. Mm-hmm. That's all I got from her. Now, you've had some email correspondence, including the New York Times.
Yes.
And I want to know what happened to the email that they gave you about a statement that they made on the front page of the New York Times.
When was it dated? March 2, 2003, Sunday edition.
It was stated by
the book. It's
by
the book.
Author yes. of on the front
Donald
page.
Donald G. McNeil Jr.
This is a well-known author of the New York Times,
very gifted
prestigious newspaper, said that Botox is giving patients with spastic vocal cords back their voices. And all we wanted to know was who told him that. He was a writer, not a researcher.
Right.
He
but,
knows
but
nothing
he had
about
to get
Botox.
From somebody.
Somebody gave him that statement.
Yes.
So what did they send you?
Donald G. McNeil Jr. is a very decent person, very civil. And he's very responsive. He sent me a printout of a study done in a medical journal that I wrote back to him and said, it's totally irrelevant. It has nothing to do with what the statement is. And they are holding their position on that basis that it is valid. Now, the assistant.
We tried to ask him very simply, just give us the reference, your source, for the statement that Botox is giving patients with spastic vocal cords back their voices.
He never did. Right.
He gave him an article that was completely irrelevant, had nothing to do with that statement. So then he further questioned the New York Times. Please come up. I couldn't get it from the author who wrote the article. Can you please look into it and tell tell the rest of the story.
Where did you get the information?
What they did is they eventually got around to having the assistant editor of the Science Times, where these stories are apparently originating from, if I'm correct, tell me that as far as he can tell, the front page story is correct. As far as I can tell, he wrote back. And I wrote back to him,
well, how can you tell?
How can you tell? You don't deal with SD cases. I see them day in and day out. And Botox is not giving them, that I see, their voices back. And the assistant editor just didn't feel right to respond to me again. I've written to the Sulzbergers.
But what was the name of the guy that wrote you back? He took this up. This was not... this is not Keller.
Cochran.
Cochran. He's the one that wrote you and said he found nothing unacceptable about what
McNeil said.
No, he said, McNeil
as far said, as I can tell...
There's nothing unusual.
That position is passable. I like the term, is passable.
You know what's interesting about
something
that?
Interesting.
Another writer from the New York Times named Judith Miller said that Saddam Hussein was stockpiling weapons of mass destruction. She said it in a series of probably 6 or 7 articles on the front page of the New York Times in the run-up to the war in Iraq. And we're talking about through 2002 to March 20th, 2003.
Dr. Curtis, you're always finding fault with people.
Wait a second, listen to this. They asked her, Judith Miller,
yes,
who is your source? Who says that he has weapons of mass destruction?
Yeah. Where'd that come from?
Where did it come from? Who was your source? You know what she said? She says, I'm not at liberty to give my source. And you know what wound up happening to her? She was thrown in jail in contempt for 85 days until finally the source released her, whose name was Scooter Libby, who's on trial right now in D.C. for lying to federal authorities, FBI agents, and a grand jury. Now, the interesting part about Miller is this was a very respected New York Times journalist who was feeding the public in the front page for front page stories statements about weapons of mass destructions that were not attributed to any source. Mm. So here you've got another story. Mm. Botox is giving patients back their spastic vocal cords. No attribution. Now, we have some speculation as to who it might be. We know that there's a vice president of product development who happens to live in New York City.
We cannot speculate
what that position is.
He's been quoted numerous times.
Yes, but we don't know because they won't respond who gave Donald G. McNeil Jr. that statement. Now, McNeil Jr. is a gifted writer, but he knows nothing about spasmodic dysphonia. Somebody fed it to him.
Yeah, he didn't pull it out of his hat.
Yeah, no. Maybe it came from the heavens. Dr. Curtis, you're very critical of people. I don't understand why you can't accept the fact that they don't want you to know too much about too many things.
Yes, I'm becoming more increasingly aware of that. I think what's instructive here is that if it looks like a conspiracy, if it walks like a conspiracy, then you know something? Maybe it is a conspiracy.
It has the sound.
What is we ask for a source, a reference. Is that like a lot to ask?
No.
Here's a major statement that's being made. Cochran says he doesn't see anything wrong with it.
No.
Well, there's nothing wrong with it except for the fact
it's not
factually accurate.
Does that make a difference in your life, Dr. Curtis?
Makes a difference in my life.
Does it?
Yeah.
Why?
Because I've got the problem. I need good information.
From my experience, they don't care about you. They're going to give you, if you had Botox, 4 to 10 times a year, each and every year for life, and the cost may be $1,000 to $2,000 to $3,000 to $4,000 a Botox shot. Now, Dr. Curtis, I'm sorry to say, folks, would like to take the money off the table for these people who are giving the Botox shot, who are supporting ex-wives or wives and children in college, and he has no sense of decency. Do you, Dr. Curtis?
You think I'm
trying to earn a decent living.
I know, it's a tough and dirty life, isn't it, I mean, to earn a living. But, I mean, don't you think that the patient counts for something?
No. Look, I always shock them. No.
Why don't you think they can't count?
First.
I mean, look, she's suffering with this condition.
The medical profession,
Dr. Curtis,
says the patient comes first, but it doesn't appear to do so in this field.
But why should the patient, why shouldn't she have the right to treatment that is effective in dealing with her problem?
Are you talking about choice? You're talking about choice?
Well, I asked the chairman of the This is the head and neck, you know, that deals with otolaryngology at the University of Michigan. His name is Norman Hokigian. Mm-hmm. I asked him how important it is for him to listen to voices before they start treatment and after. He says, we don't do things like that. I said, what do? He says, we use fiber optics. We look at vocal cords.
I said, they don't know what to make of the vocal cords when they see the strangled strain. They're not trained, John.
I said, wouldn't it be?
I've tried to tell
I
John,
said, doesn't it make more
year
sense
after year
to
they're
listen?
Not trained in voice. They don't know what to listen for.
No, wait, you can listen. Anybody can listen to
medicine,
to a clear
they're looking
voice.
For a medical. That's what they're looking
yes,
for.
Yes, but they already say
it's
you
like,
have
you
a
know,
disease.
A surgeon
soon
only looks
they
for
come
the
up
surgical
with
response.
The condition that you have spasmodic dysphonia, they're saying, see the secretary, make an appointment. Now, John, you don't get it. They're not trained in
he doesn't
practical
want
voice.
To listen to the voice.
No, he's not interested. They're interested
but
in
but they like
surgery.
Looking. What is it about, why is it, and this is a question, what is it about looking at a voice? Isn't a voice something people listen to?
No,
isn't that
not
with your ears?
John, you're not getting it.
Why do they look at voices?
Do you know, in old show business, they used to have a middleman call and something or other where he would ask the question, the other guy would come up with the answer. John, they're not interested, they're not trained. They're interested, from my experience, in doing surgery, in injecting something, in Botoxing, because that is what they're trained
but
to do.
But that's an implant.
No, implant, Botox is an implant, but it's a temporary implant.
Right, it's a temporary
that's
implant.
That's what they are trained to do.
He knows doctors that are in New York, and they're and Pennsylvania, the guy is the editor of the journal Voice. It's a very prestigious journal. You've actually published in the journal Voice, haven't
no,
you?
Never.
You never published in Sadloff's journal?
Never.
Okay.
I couldn't get into that journal with a newsie, in person with the
Well,
gentleman.
You've gotten into a lot of journals
yes,
in the past.
Yes, different, okay. But not that one.
All right. Look. But Sadloff believes in what they call, he can give somebody a voice lift. Now, it's an interesting concept because where did he come up with the name voice lift? And he believes that you've heard that, you know, for cosmetic procedures, they can inject sure. collagen right into your face and stuff. Well, he's injecting collagen into the vocal cords, saying that he can plump the cords up and make them more youthful.
We don't have to do it. We can do it with the and we'll bring the voice up.
But do you believe that collagen injections into the vocal cords will create a youthful voice?
No. No.
Then why is
because
Dr.
When they
Sadloff
put a substance,
selling this?
The vocal cords are 4/5 of an inch long in a male and 3/5 of an inch long in a female. If you put a substance into the vocal cords, you create a dysfunction of the voice, basically, from my experience. I have seen these cases. But aside from that, let's get back to this. They want to medicalize. That's what they're trained to do, and that's what they're going to do, and they make a lot of money doing it. I wish them well, because we all have to put bread on the table. We have to earn a living. Don't knock it. And that's what they're trained to do. How do you feel about your voice?
Very frustrated.
If you raise your pitch, would you be frustrated?
No. Once I can get it back up there, I'm willing to go back to my little girl voice. Okay. It's much, much better than my strangled voice.
Right. I talked to you about the breathing, right? You didn't have the breathing. SD patients hold their breath, mm-hmm. don't talk on mm-hmm. air. When they do talk on air, they let it all out, and they keep talking till they're blue
exactly,
in the face.
Exactly, exactly.
Why are you doing that?
If I knew, it would be a lot easier to solve.
your laugh is up there. You dropped your voice because you wanted to sound more professional. And if
and
I
now
may
I
so,
don't know how to get it back.
Yes, because you created a bad habit pattern. That's the answer to John and to the medical world. You created a bad habit pattern, a voice pattern. And the medics don't want to buy that because it's not in their area and they're making you a disease. Are you a disease? Did anybody ever find you had a neurological problem?
I'm not a disease, but I was definitely told it was a neurological problem.
I didn't hear that voice.
I was told it was a neurological problem.
You can change it.
I can. I
if you have a neurological problem, you can't do what you just did. Do you follow?
I do.
Why don't you just
Wait,
stay
so
up
they
there?
Said you can't change pitch of the voice.
I've she heard can change it. She's done
I've
it.
Heard physicians yeah. say, you
I,
know, that
I
they cannot change the
focus.
Pitch of a voice.
Well, that's the medical view. I'm saying it's poppycock. They're on the wrong road, and that's why they don't have a single cure in 135 years plus. So if you do what I want, you have an excellent chance of getting out of spasmodic dysphonia, the so-called hopeless and curable problem, and you're doing it naturally. But there's no money in it for the medical people. There are only 200 doing Botox shots of 14,300.
And that's a lot of money to go around.
Well,
that's a lot of money on the table.
Well, They're well-intentioned, they're humane, they're compassionate.
I know,
they're
but
on the wrong road.
It's like everything in Tony, medicine.
Why didn't
I don't
go
hear
for,
that.
I said, get my pitch up. It's like everything in medicine in America. They, you know, it's everybody wants to sell drugs.
Well, why didn't
they
you
just
go
want to
for
prescribe
Botox?
Drugs?
But Bill Clinton said this is
actually
a drug-free society. I love you. I love your laugh.
I'm asking her a question. Okay, why didn't you go for Botox? This is the easy way.
I will credit my ENT. He told me absolutely not to do that.
Really?
Why
did he tell you that?
That's interesting.
Because he said it was harmful. He said
I can't hear that.
Mm-hmm.
Harmful?
It would be harmful to my vocal cords
to do that. I can't hear that.
It would be harmful, sir, to my vocal cords.
Why didn't he stay up there? Why don't you stay up there?
Yeah, and I give him a lot of credit. But you know what? His equipment was almost as old as yours. He was old school, and he did not believe
in
Botox.
There's a book called The Last Angry Man about a doctor in Brooklyn who can't get referrals because he's one of the best diagnostic people in Brooklyn. And his colleagues show him the latest goo-goo, and he asked them, what is the latest goo-goo? And he says, the patients love it. He asked them, what does it do for the patients? He says, nothing, but they love it. That's modern society, folks. That's the way it is. We have 1 minute. Can we summarize what you're feeling about your voice? Can you change?
I can change. I just have to focus on it, change the pitch, and remember to breathe. And then I will sound a lot better.
People listening to you will say, how could that be? Why don't you just breathe? You do not breathe.
I don't breathe, not at the right times.
Yes, not for voice.
What do you say to people who say that what you do with people is you play tricks on their nervous system?
I wish I did. I can't get them to get up there.
New York State told me that.
I think that's lovely.
They say Cooper plays tricks on the nervous system.
I love that.
Hey, if the tricks would work, that would be
fine. They must think I'm another Sigmund Freud. I'm not. I'm into not psychotherapy or psychotherapy. I'm into curing hopeless voices. Thank you very much, Dr. John Curtis. Your name?
Tony Wilkers. Thank you, Doctor.
Bye-bye, folks.